merciful Lord, patient for the righteous King, loving in all your ways.
There is a very significant importance to your name. So anytime you talk about your name, heaven has a kind of a case. So today I'm building a case of a name. And when I'm building a case of a name, I'm looking at your name, not your nickname. Because nicknames will one day be discarded and disappear. But I'm looking to the real name, which is attached to your individual character, which gives you your final destiny, where you belong in the future that we are going. So today our share is what is in a name. The Bible tells us a good name is more desirable than great riches. To be esteemed is better than silver or gold. So when the Bible, this is King Solomon, is looking at the precious gold. I took a picture and I think somebody attached to this image. And this is gold. If you have certain gold, just some small portion of it, everybody could want to be close to you. So the Bible connects gold with the name. And the name exceeds your gold or silver that you have. It exceeds the money that we have. So when the psalmist or in Proverbs, King Solomon attaches the name to a very superior aspect, more than the things that we possess on this earth. That it means that the possession that we have, the things that we have, the blessings that we have encountered in this life will one day disappear. And our name will be written and be found only. You can lose so many things in this world, but your name stands firm in the kingdom of God. So this will be our share today, because we are building a case on the same. Now, if you watch that, that's a parrot, and some of us are familiar with this. And a parrot is a designed kind of a bird that you can teach and give lessons. And he can monitor your family members and even the visitors that come in your home. A parrot, when it comes up, you can even teach the language of how they can respond to questions. And a parrot can give a question. So a story is given here of a parrot. One day, some thieves came in the night. So when the thieves came in the night, they came without the intention of anybody, very dark in the night. Everybody was sleeping, and in the family, there was a parrot watching the thief that came overnight. So when the thief came, the parrot began making certain unusual announcement. Jesus is watching you. Jesus is watching you. This is a parrot. He was given information, and he got the information, and then the thief came over the night, and the parrot says, Jesus is watching you. Jesus is watching you. The thief had to slow his ambition to get what he wanted. Then he asked the question. Then he found, he took some light. He had some very strong flashlight. Flashed, and then just within one of the, within the, almost in the house, they saw a parrot and say, then he asked the question, what is your name? So the thief make a conversation with the parrot. What is your name? So the answer came in, Moses, Moses. Then the thief really thought about it. What kind of people can mention and give a parrot the name Moses, Moses? While he was pondering and thinking about it, he came in with a different mind. He says, he comes back again to the parrot. Tells the parrot, now, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? The Bible begins giving some answer. And it says, Jesus, when he was asked about Jesus, he said, Jesus is 150 proil whaler. 150 pounds proil whaler. That is what's wondering, who is this? Who is this Jesus? The story is there. In fact, that's a story. The story says, when he comes up, he says, the parrot says, my Moses. And then, who is Jesus? The bird answered, 150 pounds, road whaler. 150, road paler. Then he was wondering, who is this strong man here who can really do a lot of strength here? Then it is very important to know a name. Very important to know the name. So he attached, the parrot attached the string with the name Jesus. And he knew the string that is beneath, that the thief will never endure. And the thief had to disappear without stealing anything in the house. A child could ask a parent, what name did you give me? I don't know if you parents have got an experience with your children. And they will ask you, why did you think about this name? Why did you give me about this name? What is intended to do with this name? As a parent, I don't know what you'll do. Now, I'm giving you some statistics of what happens here in the U.S. So allow me make these statistics because I'm building a case of how important is your name. With the social security number, the census of 2013 in this country, per 1,000 Americans of 2013, between the children, male and female, how to name them? The child that topped with 11.86% among all the children in naming in different families is the name Michael. Michael became the first name that appeared to all Americans in the statistics of 2013 as a very common name. And the ladies, the first lady is Mary. And Mary has 6.8%. Which means that a number of children, if you go every homestead, every family, every community, you can easily get the name Michael. Michael, Michael, Michael. You can easily get the name Mary, 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 Mary. It's all over there. Well, this is how we take this position of naming. Now, the top baby names, girls, is Olivia. That is in the U.S. And the top man's name is Liam for the boys. Those are the names that we have in this country. A number of families have given such names. But let me now go to places within our state. There is a place in the northern side called Emperors, Minnesota, which in fact it's about, when I make a calculation, it's about 261 miles away from here, all the way. It will take you about 3 hours, 15 minutes to drive from here in church all the way to Empress, Minnesota. Now, I came to realize, why is this name given? Why was this? I don't know if you have heard about this name before. It says that this place is the very coldest place, very cold, with constant 34.4 degrees, continuously, very cold. Very cold place. You cannot admire to stay there for long when it's now summer. You will say, no, let's go, let's move to a different place. Now, this is incorporated village, gets its name from its river, which French fur traders dubbed the river the Empress, or loosely translated river of obstacles. It may be not be an embarrassing place to live, but it probably isn't very comfortable. It bears the dubious distinction of being the coldest place in Minnesota. 34.4 degrees, 260 miles away from here, 3 hours, 15 minutes. Impressive. So there are certain names that are given to places that at times gives you a question of thinking, what kind of name is this? Let's go further. Let's go to Mississippi. a place called Why Not. So you can go and get a signpost at Coastfield and find a place where it is called Why Not. And that question, you ought to answer it, why not? And you cannot understand why the question is, how this place? David Ruffin, one of the chroners in the Temptations, came from his sparsely populated settlement near Mississippi eastern border. No one knows who gave it this name or why, but after all, why not? So after all, that question is there, you say, why not? When you want to ask the question, you will not ask you will not get the answer. But at the end of it, you will say, why not? There is a place in Maryland, in Michigan, a place called Huxleyden. And you can see the welcome to Huxleyden, Maryland. And you, those who are driving on the way, definitely you will come to realize there are certain names that are given to our signposts that at times we tend and think about, and we even don't know why those names were given. Get this story. A small town in the mountains of Far Eastern Maryland is a home to just over 300 people, right? Then the origin of its name is known for sure. But listen as it starts, one land speculator told another that he would mark of this plot by accident. So he marked the place by accident. So therefore, he marked the place by accident, and then the name became accident. It is there by accident to today. So it tells our names that are given, and are provided. So at times there are questions. So in different names that we have, are samples of them here. The good friend, somebody can say, the good friend, that is also our name. Somebody says the show one, the peep, the charge little charge girl, the shy one, the one that always swears, the drama queen, the lazy one, the gangster. There are so many names people give to different people. Some of the American choices at times surprises us. And I came to realize that there are certain names here in America which are already been inscribed. 149 names, those are girls and boys, are being mentioned to be hallow. So a child is called hallow. So you can get these 149 girls and 225 boys. Then we have Amen, which is very close to religion, and much more very close to the church. Amen are 75 boys, 55 girls. Then Galfari, 6 girls. Galfari, 16 girls, 7 boys. 1, Lucifer, 24 boys. And Getsemane, 11 girls. So if you call your child Lucifer, say, yes, mom, Lucifer. So these are names that are there and given, and time shocks. Then one name, in fact, that was scripted by court is Nutella, and a number of you have got it. In 2015, a court in the city of Valencia ruled that a couple could not name their daughter Nutella when the parents failed to show up on their court date. The judgment renamed the 4-month-old baby Hella. The name Nutella given to the child is the trademark of a spread. The court official decision read, adding that it is contrary to the child's interest to be named Nutella, as it is, can only be led to teasing or disparaging thoughts. Look at that. So at times when you are watching and telling names, be careful. You know why names are there. A good name, therefore, is desirable, greater, and the riches that we have, esteemed, very important. Your name is attached to so many things. And God wishes that we have this name. Let's go back to the background. With the Jewish name, a reflection of cultural values. The Jewish knew how to boot names, to attach some traditions and culture to the name of a child. And the child, when he's born, or before the child is born, a character is formed already in the mindset of the parents. So the moment a child is born, there is a kind of a ceremony that is installed for the naming of a child. So a child was not only given by the parent alone, but it was a kind of a connection between the parents and the elders, or the Jewish as a group. So these are the stories. The beginning, name was defined. Ancient Jews named the person or the place which in fact they had to capture one's personality, which was very unique in building the names of the children. Like the Hebrew names, like the name El Shaddai, God Almighty. This was particularly, when you call God El Shaddai, you give him the position of God. So the Jewish knew exactly how to mention the name of God. They could not only mention Jehovah God only, but they knew what kind of power is intended and is needed here. So when God is in war, the name of God was El Shaddai. He's at war. He's almighty. And he will fight and he will destroy the enemies. So the naming of a Jewish child is most profound, a spiritual moment. The researcher says that the naming of a baby is a statement of her character, her specialities, and her path in life. And that is significant to the Jewish. Hebrew traditions of naming a baby boy and a baby girl was different. So for a baby child, announcement for a baby boy, the Hebrew name was a kind of a priest after 8 days. So a child is born, then the eighth day, there is a special ceremony installed. And that eighth day that was installed, the ceremony, a child was born. For a girl, naming ceremony at the first opportunity when the Torah is read. So when the Torah is the Ten Commandments that were given to them. All right. So did the Jewish, the same way it was attached to a book. So the name was attached to a book. So when you mention a name, you mention a book. A book is just the book as it is. A child when he's born is a book and written. And clear pages. So many pages with. So when the child begins, a character and a life is written and inscribed in a page of life. So a name is inscribed in the book. That's how Judaism and the Hebrew, it was attached to the soul, which in fact it has life. That's how the Hebrews use the word shin and mem. And shin and mem is just connecting for the name. So when you call them shin and mem, it's a kind of connecting the name with the soul or life of the very person that his name is individual. That's how they did it, and that's how the story is. And let's go back. A name is so precious. Now let's go to the text and the Bible now. The book of Isaiah 43 in verse 1 from the English Standard Version. I got this message. But now thus saith the Lord, he who created you, hey Jacob, who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. This is good news to a Christian. Because our Christianity and our faith in God, our connection with Christ Jesus as members of his household, he knows us. He knows our name. The way King Solomon says, the name is precious. Isaiah, as a prophet, endorses the name. And he gives that, don't worry. Don't hesitate your Christian life. Meditate upon his word. Live with his word. Because God has called you by name. You are his own. You belong to him. Your name is known. And God knows exactly what is in your heart. Let's go further again to the Exodus chapter 3, 33, verse 17. And the Lord said to Moses, is this very thing that you have taken, I will do for you. I have found favor in the sight, and I know your name. This is Moses talking to God, illustrating information. Moses has a lot of hesitation with how God, his name is. Then he asked God, what is your name? And God has to inscribe his name. And when God gave his name, he told him, I am that I am. So when God revealed his name to Moses, Moses was confident. And he knew that I am mentioning the name and a personality connected with me. So wherever Moses went to Pharaoh and talked about God, he knew him in person. He knew him and he knew his character. So when Moses took a stick and threw it into the hands of the king, and it turned into a snake, It was not just a kind of a mystical power, a witchcraft power that was there, but he knew the personality. He told God, "What will I tell Pharaoh?" Then God says, "I am that I am." Then he took a stick and threw it. It turned into a snake. Then the magicians who came also says, "We can also do the same. After all, you have a mighty power. We have also a mighty power." They threw their kind of sticks. They turned into small snakes. So when they turned into small snakes, the very snake, the powerful, almighty God, El Shaddai, whose name is a person, a present, swallowed all of them. When he swallowed them, they were all amazed and says, "What a wonder. We've never experienced such thing. A name is great." In Psalms 91, verse 14, the Bible continues, "Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name." This is great for a Christian. He knows our names. Let's continue. Revelation chapter 3, verse 12. Verse 12, the Bible continues, "In heaven, when Christ will come, he will have finished the work of giving a case of every name. Those who mentioned his name, those who committed their lives to him, those who really became Christians, and they all committed their lives." The Bible continues, "The one who conquers, the one who fights, the one who will overcome, I will make him a pillar in the temple of God. Never shall he go out of it, and he will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven, and my own new name." I saw three things here very, very significant. Number one, the name has a title, God. Because when he says in the heaven, "I will write a name of my God," the Revelator John looks at the Christian and he says, because he has committed his life before God and he has committed entirely everything to God, God says, "I will make a confirmation. And the confirmation that I will do, I will write my name," covering your name. So when God inscribes his name in front, it means that what will appear in the presence of God is Jesus. And Jesus comes with other names, other characters, and other beings who've accepted him. Then he says, "I will give them my name and the name of the city there where they belong, and much more, a new name." Which means our names here that we have one day is just nicknames. But the very name that we have is Jesus Christ in our lives. Now, I got this. These are so many. This is just one verse, but I wanted the parallel passages from different versions. And I saw these good versions from Malachi chapter 3, verse 16. That tells us that those who feared the Lord talked to each other, and God listened and heard. The scroll of remembrance were written in his presence concerning those who feared the name, who feared the Lord and honored his name. Now, I'm looking at what these versions are. This is now, there are so many, don't worry because of the passages that we have, but it's just one text. What I'm looking at is a name is mentioned, and God listens. A name is talked, and God says, "Yes, I'm listening." Then he found a number of one or two people making a conversation. There are people who are talking about the name of the Lord, whether it is within the community, whether it is within the church, whether it is in the family, or where. But these people are making communion together, and they're discussing about God. Then God removes the book. And when God removes the book, he entitles the book or puts the book of headline, it says remembrance, the book of remembrance. Where names are placed in that book, and everyone who talked anything about God, if you say, "I fear God," and you say, "I love God," and you say, "God is great," and when whatever you say are written in that book, then it means All the things that we say today as Christians will not go in vain. They are recorded. Even the things that we carelessly put it and we don't even care about them are recorded. Look at this. I'm just going ahead of it. Now, I found it from Ellen G. White on the great controversy on the topic facing our life record. And Helen White gave us this presentation, which I made some little quotation about. I will not read the whole passage, but allow me read this. That thus presented to the prophet visions, the great and solemn day, when the characters and the lives of men shall pass in review before the church over all the earth, and to every man should be rendered according to his works. The Ancient of Days is God, the Father, says the Psalms, before the mountains were brought forth, even thou hast been formed, the earth or anything in the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art been God. Psalms 90 verses 2, it is the source. It says everything that comes before God, it will go into tribunal. 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands attend this great tribunal. Then it means during the judgment day, all the names will appear in the presence of God. Pastor Adam's name will be mentioned without the wife, and will appear in the screen in heaven. The way we have technology today, God has high tech than us. And when God reviews the names, he gives you the character. Since you became, when you are born in this world, at times somebody says, when God gives you the panorama view of how you have been, there are some places you will tell God, hold, don't show it. Because it will appear to every race and every generation. But this is heaven, and God is doing it purposely for you. And when his name is mentioned, then God qualifies the person. But Jesus is saying, I'm pleading with my own blood. It is my name that has saved the sinner. It is my name that has given opportunity to the sinner to sail from evil into righteousness. And it is my grace that has given him permission to go to heaven. So God guarantees us in the judgment hall that we can qualify to enter heaven without our strength, but by his grace. The record book, the books of record in heaven in which the names and the deeds of men are registered, are to be determined the decisions of the judgment, says the prophet Daniel. The judgment was set and the books were opened. That is Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, all the way to verse 4. The judgment was set and the books were opened. The revelator describes the same scene. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Which means that there is nothing we can hide before God. If books will be written, I know we have records. Like here in the US, if you mess up with your life, and you have messed up with your record and your social security, you cannot get anything. You will find yourself in the street, definitely, because nobody will welcome you. You will become somebody that is really known, your character is known, and everybody will be watching over you. And even the security will check on you daily because of what your character is. But if you have if your personality and your social security is good, you can move from anywhere, from New York all the way to Minnesota, from Minnesota all the way to Florida. No question. And you, nobody will question you the same. But when your name is monitored and you have a crime and knows somebody has a problem, a question over you, you will never move. People will be checking and detecting. Where is he? They will tell the police, check on this guy. Monitor him. Look at his position. Where he's going? Where is he going? He's a bad guy. If these things can monitor us here on earth, what about heaven? God knows us, and he's dealing with a case that he will do. Okay, names of cell saints. The book of life contains the names of all who have entered the service of God. Amen. If you have entered into the service of God and really committed yourself to God, even committing yourself to come to church, take the Bible, come to church, talk about God, share the word of God, come and worship with him. Anybody who have entered into the service of God, not as a preacher like me and Adam, not like any other person, but if you have entered into the service of God and committed just an inch of your life for heaven, the Bible says they will be written in the book of life. And then what happens? The book of life contains names of all who have entered service to him. And then, and it's rejoice. This is now from the book of Luke chapter 10 verse 20. Rejoice because your names are written in heaven. So we don't struggle to ask God in our prayer, God, write our names. That's our struggle in the prayer all the times. So when we pray, we ask God, can you write our names? So we don't persuade God to write our names. Our character and our works will divine our names to be written in the book. And God, that's how God divines us. Then he continues. Paul speaks of his faithful fellow workers whose names are written in the book of life. And these are now friends who believe in him. And in Philippians chapter 4, verse 3, Daniel, looking down a time of trouble such as never was, declared that God's people shall be delivered. Everyone that shall be found written in the book. And Revelator says that those only who shall enter into the city of God, whose names are written in the books of the Lamb. So our names will be mentioned. There's that book of remembrance that we saw it. The Judgment Day of Account would definitely say, now this is how I was thinking about in Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37. There's something that shocked me that I found here. The Bible, this is the writings, when Matthew says in verse 36, I say to you, on day men stand before God, they will have to give an account for every word they have spoken that was not important. Look at that. Every word they have spoken which is not important. There are so many words which are very important. There are jokes. At times we make jokes and say and laugh and go and forget them. So they are written. So it means that we have angels who are very close to me who knows where I am. He knows what I'm saying. He knows what I'm thinking. He knows what I will say before I say. Even the very thoughts, the very inner thoughts, before I make any statement or any move, it has already been recorded by angels that this guy wants to make a murder. Like for a case, somebody says, like a spouse in the family, the wives or the husband feels that this man is becoming a nuisance in the home. God, can I begin killing this guy? So it is in the mind before the action. So when the action comes in, definitely it is defined. This person was a destructive murder. He could do that. So this is how the Bible says every word will be mentioned by God. And then it says, for it is by your words that you will not be killed, you will be found killed, but your words will be found. And then ask, this is Philippians 4:3, and that's what we have read before. Let me close by saying, it is important and paramount for every Christian to acknowledge that your name takes a very significant role in heaven. It's attached to your personality and your character. Many names will be mentioned and others will be discarded. And if your name is not found in heaven, you will not qualify to go to heaven. But no human being will say so-and-so will go to heaven, so-and-so will not go to heaven. That's why we have been kept in darkness. Not even the pastor, not even the elder, nobody knows who will go to heaven, who will not go to heaven. That's why the judgment belongs to God. He will give judgment to every one of us. There are people who will get surprises. Now, surprises are the second coming of Jesus. Ellen White says, you will be surprised to see people you never expected to go to heaven. And the people you expected to go to heaven, they will not go there. I was shocked with that statement. People that you didn't expect, they will go to heaven. You will find them in Jerusalem greeting you and saying, welcome. Then you will wonder, how did this guy come in? You will ask God, is there a way you can reverse this statement of the, but because the grace of God and the mindset will be changed by then, you will definitely say no. Our struggle today is God knows my name. And if he knows my name, therefore, let's keep our name closer to the personality that God has given to us. So when he appears for the second time, I will appear like him. And he will say, welcome my son and my daughter into the kingdom of God by his grace. Then Christ will introduce us before God. This is so and so. This will say, this is Adam praying now. Then, you know, by that day, pastor, at times you not really, you will appear with your name. And then your wife and your children will appear. And then they will also go. Your name will be mentioned and then you will be ushered in. I don't know how that will be done. But the judgment seat will be done. And Christ will be done with the work of judgment. When he comes for the second time, he knows who will go to heaven. And he knows who will not go to heaven. But for us, it is kept in darkness. There's something that I was shocked when I read it, that when somebody dies, there is 1 minute kept in his mind of making a decision. So when somebody dies, just like the doctors will tell us and provide the medical providers will tell us, there is a 60 seconds, it is a 60 minute, not 60 minutes, but 60 seconds in suspense that is given to that individual person immediately. The heart stops and the whole system stops. The part of the brain, 60 seconds, will remain. And that is the time either somebody can make a decision for heaven or for hell. That's why at times when somebody dies and he was a bad guy, you don't mention judgment and say, this one is ready for hell. Leave that. Don't say such a name. Don't say so and so is ready to go to heaven. And you didn't know. So you don't, at times when we are ready there, we say, by the grace of God, God knows the destiny of this individual. Then when we hand somebody into the hands of God, God will give the answer finally. It's my prayer that God will give us the knowledge and give us the understanding, that our names will be mentioned and our names will appear in the kingdom. Is that your prayer? God bless you. Merciful.